Have a lot of stuff in your life that you don't really have use for. What's that? What'd you say?
Sleepless.
And why is that?
Dealing with the clutter.
You're thinking about the clutter. You're thinking about all the stuff that's in your life. So a cluttered life looks like all of those things. It's a bunch of stuff that you don't really have use for, but you think you might use it, or you think it might have some use. How do our lives get cluttered? How do we get to the point where our lives have all this stuff in it that we don't really have use for?
Because you take on more than one thing and never complete one project. You just add it on and add it on.
You take on things that, really you probably shouldn't take on, right? Somebody last session said responsibilities. And I said, well, responsibility's not bad, is it, to have responsibilities? But some responsibilities you ain't supposed to have. They're not yours. You can leave them alone. Why do we allow ourselves to be overextended to the point of stress? Why do we take on responsibility? Why do we do things to the point where we can't sleep? We have a poor diet.
Can't say no.
That's right.
Ooh. I'm sorry. That's supposed to be this. People pleasing, can't say no. And I put people pleasing first because that's usually the number one answer.
That's right. That's what they tell me.
Why else?
Not able to set boundaries or prioritize.
No boundaries. Can't prioritize.
No purpose.
Lack of purpose.
It makes you feel needed.
Need to feel needed.
Control is not first.
I heard low self-esteem. Mm-hmm.
Control.
Guilt. I heard guilt.
Well, you said God is not first.
Control.
Control. I heard control. That's a big one.
Somebody say guilt.
Bill avoid. Well, yeah.
Or avoiding.
Avoidance.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have a long one. I'm going to stop here only for the sake of time, because I know there's a whole lot of other things we could name here. And we're going to revisit that list in a little while. But we're going to revisit the list. But so why not say no? Thinking about what you find hard to say no to, why do you do what you do? What's your motive?
You don't want to hurt people's feelings.
Oh, that's people pleasing, isn't it?
Yeah.
What else?
Insecurity.
That you're insecure. Yep. Anything else? Why else would you not say no to something?
You don't want to disappoint people.
You don't want to disappoint people. Anybody here think that they could do things better themselves?
Yeah.
That could be control. Some of us are overconfident. What else can make you not say no to something that you feel like you should say no to?
You're the hostess with the mostess. You think that only you can do it?
Only you can do it. You're the one with the equipment, and nobody, or somebody. You don't want somebody else to do it. That can't
trust. You don't trust somebody.
You don't trust. Mm-hmm. That's a good one. That's a big one. So there's all kinds of reasons why we don't say no. And what are your best reasons for why you do what you don't have time, desire, aptitude, or help to do? Time, desire, aptitude, or help. We take on these things that we never should have just based on that. What are your best reasons? So some of the best reasons, like you said, we don't want to hurt anybody's feelings. It's a good reason, but not really.
People feel obligated.
Okay.
So obligation,
right? Commit. There's nothing wrong with being committed. Right? I love a loyal person. Flaky people kind of work my nerves. You say you're going to do something, do it. And follow through and do a good job. Right? So I put that on myself because that's what I would like to see in other people. That's not very godly of me to put that expectation on other people either. But it's one of the motivators. It's one of the reasons why we do what we do. So there's a story in our Bible that gives us two examples of somebody whose life is cluttered and somebody who can say no. Jesus said to Martha. Martha, Martha, you are anxious and worried about many things. There is need of only one thing. And Mary has chosen the better part, and it will not be taken from her. Mary and Martha. So when you think of a Mary, who is, let's define a Mary. If I say that a person is a Mary kind of spirit, what am I saying?
They love the word.
They love the word. What else does a Mary look like? She's restful. She's peace. Confident. Peace. She's confident enough to say no, right? Mm-hmm. All right. What? Anybody else? What's Mary represent?
God first.
Put God first.
Yeah.
All that. And wait. Jesus is here.
Yeah.
He's in my house. He, do you? You must. Y'all must not know what he's going to do for us. I got. Mm-hmm. If you think of a Martha. How would you describe a Martha person?
Busy.
Martha's
making preparations, doing stuff.
I'm laughing at this. When did you put it up? Because every Christmas, I hope it's Christmas. And every Christmas, my prayer is, Lord, help me to be more of a Mary than a Martha. Every Christmas, because I'm running around hosting, and I can't do. And, you know, it's just. So I need this.
I have Martha. I don't worry more. Everything just has to be just so. And if it's not that way, she just freaks out.
I would say that describes Martha pretty well. Mm-hmm. But you have to understand that in Jewish culture back then, hospitality was everything. Mm-hmm. If you were not a good host, then your name was mud in the Jewish community. Mm-hmm. So they had folks in their house. And Martha's all about. My culture is telling me I got to get dinner ready. We got to do this. You know, the food got to be right. It's got to be served on time. We got to do all this stuff. And she's like, I don't know what is wrong with my sister. We raised in the same house. She knows what we're supposed to be doing. She was, what did Jesus say? You are anxious and worried about many things. Some translations say, and I should have put that one up, you're distracted. You're distracted by all this stuff. And I'm here.
Material things.
By earthly things. Why was Mary able to say no?
Focus.
The only way you want them to say no, the only way you want to unclutter, focus. What was her interest? Jesus. You see why I crossed out me first? Putting God first? You put God first, and then you can figure out what needs to be done and what doesn't need to be done. Mary had the greater things in mind. Mary knew what was most important. So she kept her focus so she was able to put away the clutter in her life. So it says, what's love got to do with everything? Love's got to do with everything that I'm talking about today. And I'm not just talking about everyday love, any kind of love. The folk that come to Monday Night Bible Study know that I talk about the gospel all the time. And what do I say? What do I mean by the gospel? We're going to look at it in a minute. But basically, who else did sacrifice their life for your sake? Nobody but
Jesus.
But Jesus. Love. Somebody define love for me.
Strong feeling.
Forgiving.
Dying to self.
Commitment.
Unconditional. So, love is actually beyond feeling. Love means no matter how I feel about you, I'm going to do what's best for you. Jesus in the garden. In the Garden of Gethsemane. Wrestling. His flesh. Flesh didn't want to be torn away from his bones. Flesh didn't want to be beaten and mocked and with a crown of thorns. Flesh didn't want people to be spitting at him and calling him names. Flesh didn't want to get on that cross and bear the sins of the world, past, present, and future, and cause separation between him and his Father. Flesh, all of that. He's wrestling with that. He's saying, if you can take this, if we can do this another way, God, that would be my preference. But in the end, he put the things of God first. Not your will, God, but not my will, God, but your will. Your will be done. And so despite the fact that he knew that these people, these sinful people, as the Bible tells us, that while we were yet sinners, he died for us. Despite who we are, despite the stuff he knew we were going to do, despite the fact that we knew that we were going to blaspheme him, turn our backs on him, he went to the cross for each and every one of us. That is love. If you ever want a definition of love, you need to look at a cross. The cross equals love. Valentine's Day, we make hearts and cross. That's love. So what's love got to do with it? If you can remember this love, if you can remember that God showed how much he loved us by sending his one and only son into the world so that we might have eternal life through him, this is real love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his son as a sacrifice to take away our sins. We love because he loved us first. You can't love. The Bible says, love your neighbor what?
As yourself.
How you going to love yourself unless you accept that God died for you, that Jesus Christ died for you? That has to be first. And then we can practice unconditional love on other people, but we got to start with ourselves.
Amen.
So even though I crossed that me out, I want you to show how the me and the God is related. You're a child of God too.
Yeah.
You got to look out for the child of God. God loves you. God thought you were worth it. How come you don't think you're worth it? Mary knew that God thought she was worth it. Martha forgot. Right? And we forget. We forget because we take our focus off for our family and for our friends, but doesn't compare to this unconditional love. And so this is something we have to know and understand. What's love got to do with it? It needs to get into your heart, into your spirit, that this is the center of my life. This is what everything in my life has to revolve around. And I have to make some decisions based on the love that God had for me. I'm not going to read this. This is 1 Corinthians 15:3-9. This is where the simple gospel is. Christ died for our sins, and he buried and raised from the dead. Anybody ask you what is the gospel? This is the simple gospel. He died, buried,
raised.
That's it. So what do you think about when you hear once again how Jesus died for you? And what's your response? That's the thing. It's not good enough to go, yup, Christian, Jesus died for me, and then keep moving in a way that you're not supposed to keep moving. New moves. I recognize that Jesus is my Savior. He died for me. He wants me to be all that I can. So I got to do some things differently now. I got to get rid of some stuff in my life. I got to get rid of this clutter. I need to respond to the gospel by getting rid of the stuff that distracts me from what I'm doing. So how many things in your life are done as an authentic response to the truth of the gospel? That's for you to answer. That's for you to think about. But the thing is, who wants you to be marked? Who wants you to be distracted? Who wants your life cluttered? The enemy. The enemy knows that if he can get you doing stuff you got no business doing, you don't have time to sit at his feet. You don't have time for God. And guess what? Sin equals busyness, or busyness equals sin. All these things you listed over here, people pleasing, can't say no, no boundaries, can't sin. But that's all about self. That's all about the things that are wrong in us, not about the things that are right. So I just made my own list, and you can compare. You can compare to the list that we gave. But these are all reasons why we can't say no. These are all reasons why we can't say no. Self-reliance. I can do it better, or I can do it. Mistrust. We talked about that. Just being discontent. I'm trying to find the thing that's going to make me happy. Self-righteousness. I can do this better than anybody else. Faithlessness. I'm not faithful to God, so I'm going to be faithful to all these other things. Materialism. Idolatry. I skipped idolatry. Big one, because for those of you that have children, you know your children can be idols, right?
Mm.
If your kids are in soccer, kuma, choir, piano,
gymnastics,
all at once, nothing wrong with your kids being in activities, but they don't have to be in every activity under the sun because you think you need to be a good mom to your kids. Being a good mom, we didn't get all that stuff. We had some good mothers. Right? Your kids are not going to fall behind. They're not going to lack for anything if they are not your world. Your children, God bless them. You love them. They should not be the center of your world.
Amen.
God should be the center of your world. Mm-hmm. And if God is the center of your world, you will give them the proper attention. You will give them all the things that they need. It's about the priority. Right? You got to put God first and all those other things. Seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. So busyness is sin. That's the stuff that drives us. The enemy knows exactly what he's doing. You ever heard this acronym? Busy. Being under the yoke, under Satan's yoke. Yep. So it's a tool. He's using that. He's using clutter and busyness in your life to put you under the yoke. So how do you get rid of the clutter? How do you maintain the things of God? How do you get like Mary and say no? He said Mary had focus, right? You have to focus. Focus is the tool of declutter. Right? If you are, I'm sorry, let's go back. Philippians 4, 6 through 9. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Mm-hmm. Tell God what you need. Thank him for all he has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ. And now, dear brothers and sisters, one final thing. Fix your thoughts. Fix your thoughts on what is true and honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable. All the things of God. Fix your thoughts. Keep putting into practice. Right? You got to keep doing this because it does not come naturally, right? Keep putting into practice all you learned and received from me, meaning Paul. Everything you heard from me and saw me doing, then the God of peace will be with you. We have to make sure that we have our thoughts fixed, our minds fixed, our focus laser sharp, in order to not be distracted, in order to not get busy with stuff that ain't supposed to be in our lives. So, focus. Keeping a greater goal in mind is helpful when you're decluttering in general. Right? When you're cleaning out your garage, closet, or room, the moment you lose focus, you waste time. And you might get discouraged, and you might want to stop whatever you're doing. You're purging, or you're reorganizing, or whatever. And the greater goal is lost, which is to put some order, right? And to get to get some space so you can think. It's the same. The same is true in life. The greater goals of a closer walk with God, spiritual maturity, and glorifying the Lord will help you identify what needs to go from your life. Right? You think of some things that are going to be all about God, about glorifying God. You trust me. You take care of Him. He'll take care of you. Do not worry about you. The things that don't do any of those things, are walking with God, spiritual maturity, and glorifying. Those are the things that are dispensable. Those are the things that need to go. Right? So, running my kids around or doing an extra task in church might be a good thing. Right? These might be helpful things, and maybe you do have the ability to do those things. But if God has a greater purpose for you, if God has designed you to do some other stuff, you need a plumb line or something to measure what needs to stay and what needs to go. You need a standard, right, so that you know what you need to include. Every good thing is not a God thing. Everything that's good and can bless somebody doesn't mean that you were the one that was supposed to do it. Right? So we have to be very prayerful about that and know what your purpose is. So, along the lines of purpose, do you know the passion, plan, or purpose for your life? The things that you're passionate about. So there's some definitions in the booklet when you get a chance to look up. But core beliefs. Core beliefs drive it. Your passions are driven by core beliefs. Something that you believe to your heart. Right? What we do is driven by core beliefs, good and bad. Right? So you have to figure out what is really important to you. What are things that you don't want to really waver from? If you're a Christian, that's a core belief, that you believe in Jesus Christ, that I believe that Jesus died for me. That's a core belief. And other things need to be guided by that core belief. You know it's a core belief when somebody tries to tell you you're wrong about something or tries to correct a behavior or a statement maybe that you made. If you get really mad about it, really mad, there's a core belief at stake. Somebody is challenging your belief. Somebody is stepping on your belief. Somebody's trying to change you or change your belief. We will fight over our beliefs. think I preached that. But anyway, so our core beliefs are some are things that drive us, but you know what? A lot of our core beliefs are things that God has allowed in our lives. We get them from our experiences, but God has allowed these core beliefs because he's going to use some of these beliefs for the work that he has purposed for you to do. So you need to evaluate those things, and you need to figure out what your unique gifts are, what your spiritual gifts are. So we have some gifts that are basically we're born with. Like some of us can sing, we can sing since we came out the womb. Some of us can dance, some of us can draw, some of us can teach, some of us can do all these other things. I'm talking about vocationally. That's a gift, a natural gift, right? That's something that you can do with ease or that you have an ability. But a spiritual gift is not a natural gift. Spiritual gift is a gift that you get the moment that you become a believer in Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit comes to reside in you. He gives you a special ability. But that ability, yeah, it could be for you, but primarily it's for the kingdom. That ability is to bring to the body of Christ. So I always said if everybody identified their spiritual gifts and brought them to the church, there would be no lack. Nobody would need anything because whatever I need, somebody's got. That's why he equips us. He gives us all these things. So if you know what your spiritual beliefs are, you know that that's something that God wants to use for your purpose. And then there are experiences that God has given you in life. I have been a teacher, classroom teacher. I have 4 children. I've had my heart broken in some difficult relationships. I've had some wonderful relationships. I've had some really great experiences, and I've had some not so great experiences. But every single one of them, and I thank God for all of those experiences. Because I'm a product right now of all of those experiences. But what experiences has God given me that brings me to this point in my life? What experiences has he given me that I taught for 13 years. I never wanted to be a teacher. But God gave me some equipment. He gave me some tools, right? He gave me some things that he was going to use for him. I didn't know that at the time. God has done the same thing with you. Whatever it is, it could be baking. Could be something, you know, could be that you're a great cleaner, that you clean your house, and that there was something that your parents instilled in you through that experience. Could be whatever it is that God has given you some of your experiences. All of these shape you. All these shape you. In the back of your book, there's a reading list. And there's 2 books on that reading list. One called, everybody knows this one, The Purpose Driven Life. If you've not read it, you need to figure out what the purpose is. Right? Second one is called Kazon. And my beautiful friend here, Liz, got me into this little study. Called Kazon. Kazon is a Hebrew word for vision. And it's about, it takes these core beliefs and the spiritual gifts and your experiences, and you look at where they all overlap. And then you develop a vision statement for your life. Like, I see where this stuff is. There's these themes. You see themes within these things. And then I think my vision statement was something like to create environments that promote spiritual maturity and growth for the people of God. Right? Through the gifting that I saw that I had, through the experiences that I had, and through the beliefs and values that I had, this is what God created. What I'm doing today, this is what God created me to do. So, but not too long ago, my beloved Miss Betty, and I knew it was coming because she told me about the Good Friday program. So she calls me like an executive producer or whatever, but it's really like everything other than acting and singing. So I'm taking Greek and Hebrew, and got a bunch of stuff on my plate, counseling and doing all kinds of stuff. And I'm like, and I just did this kazon, I'm like, this does not fall into my kazon. I don't think I'm supposed to be doing this. And God quickly came behind me and said, your kazon is creating environment. And I created an environment that promotes spiritual maturity and growth. Yeah, people were listening and watching. Hopefully people got, you know, grew a little bit that day. It fell exactly into my kazon. Yes. I can't dictate those, but now that I have this vision statement, I have focus. I have something I can go, yep, that doesn't fall in there. Nope, not doing that. Right? I have to talk to God about it, obviously, make sure that it doesn't. But it's something that if you have that purpose, then you have something to measure. You have something in which to say, this does not glorify God through me. Somebody else is supposed to glorify God doing this. This is not what God is asking me to do to glorify him. because it's all about that first and foremost. So the question was, what has God fashioned you to be? Because God, when he created you, he had something in mind. He knew already exactly what he wanted you to be. But we don't spend any time with God trying to figure out what that is. And I don't care how old we are. If you're breathing, you got a purpose.
Amen.
He keeping you here for something.
Amen.
And like I said, and I call it a vision, before we call it a purpose statement, but I call it a vision statement because a vision statement is broad. And it might look different in different stages of your life. You know, and who knows what it's going to be. But we all need to figure out, talk to God and ask him, what would you have me to be? So if somebody says, all right, so can you, you think you can serve dinner at the such and such occasion, and you already have things that you know that you have plans to do, you can say, no, that's not really what God has purposed me to do. Not that you don't want to because you think you're above that, or it's not about a want to. Like, I tried that. God didn't let me do it. It's not about a want to. It's about what is God going to do? How can God use me best? And everything that God uses is to his glory, but it's always to our benefit.
Yeah.
Always. God works all things for the good of those who love him and are called according to his purpose. So you don't have to worry about if God's going to ask you to do something you're not going to like, or God's going to ask you to do something that's not going to benefit you. Because anything he asks you to do, he's going to make sure you get a little something out of it.
Amen.
And I say a little something sarcastically, because if you take time to receive it, it'll be windows of blessings. Right, so putting yourself first in a godly way, making sure that you hear him, and making sure you know what your focus is, what your purpose is, you know, being like Mary. So that those lists of sins, let me just say too, some of you may not be feeling like your lives are cluttered. Some of you might be feeling, yeah, I'm doing pretty good. I don't feel stressed. I'm not losing weight. I'm you know, okay. But that the question you need to ask yourself, how much time are you spending with God? I mean, real time. Real time. Not just rolling out the bed, thank you, Jesus, for waking me up this morning. Some real quiet time. And I encourage you to take advantage of where you are this weekend. If you don't have a regular time with God, your life is cluttered. Your life is cluttered. You might not have known it. So take some time to make sure that you know that I have to be able to make sure that I get my marching papers from God every single day, that he's showing me my purpose, and that everything I do is about his glory. So going back to where we talked about that busyness is sin, here's the complete list. I want you to take a moment and look at some of these things. This is not an exhaustive list. God might be showing you now, or he might show you later, something else that's not up there. About what sin in you keeps you from being married? What sin in you keeps you from being able to focus and being at his feet because you got all this stuff shoving Jesus out the way? Right? What is making you say yes to stuff that is not necessary in your life? Taking responsibilities that are not yours. Think about it for a minute. And while you're doing that, there's a space in your pulpit. Not yet. Sorry. One more slide. How do you get from sin to not having a sin anymore? Jesus has forgiven. What is it?
Repentance.
Now Jesus already forgave you for it, but you don't want just forgiveness. You want to be free. Forgiveness is not being free. It just means it's not going to be held over your head. But if you're still doing these things, you're not free. He's still forgiving you for it. We want freedom. So the way to get to freedom is repentance. That means you're walking out of Egypt, right?
Okay.
So how do you get out of Egypt? First thing is confession. First thing you got to acknowledge. That's why I asked you to look at that list. First thing you got to pinpoint something to tell God about. You got to confess to him, yeah, God, you know what? This people-pleasing thing is really out of control. I keep forgetting that if you love me, why do I care about who else loves me? And that's the heart of it. That you who created the universe died for me. You love me. Why don't I worry about that? I need to change that. How do we get from confession to actually not doing it? Because confession is the beginning of it. Every day we're supposed to confess our sins, right? Because we sin every day. You didn't know that. There's a variation. We sin daily. So every day we're supposed to confess. But the reason for confession is so that you get it. God already knows before you confess. You know that? Mm-hmm. The word confession in Greek means agree. To say the same. So what you're doing is, yep, God, you're right. That's what you do when you confess. So that's the first step. You got to acknowledge it. You can't change anything you don't acknowledge. Second step is godly sorrow. You got to break your heart. You got to get your own heart broken. My class is Monday nights. Don't like to hear that. I say that all the time. You got to break your own heart. Godly sorrow, because let me tell you the difference between, you know, feeling bad about something and having real sorrow about it or having remorse. So if someone is in prison, they're up for the review board. They're really testing to see if they're remorseful, right? Why is that important for them to figure out if the person has remorse? Because if they don't, they're going to go out and do it again. Now, and some of them immediately. So what they do is they're looking at them to see if they're just sorry they got caught and sorry they had to spend some time, or if they're really sorry for what they did. And often we're sorry because of the consequences of what we do, not because we've broken God's heart. So knowing that you've broken God's heart, you got to get your own heart broken. Because it's the one whose heart is broken that decides they need to make a change. So you got to get from confession to godly sorrow. And then the last part, turn away. Turn away. Make moves. Get some new moves. So we're singing a new song. We heard one song. Y'all going to hear another song. And as you're listening to the song, there's a page in there that's a confession to God or a letter to God or a prayer to God. I want you to think about the things, or if you haven't thought about anything, ask God to show you. The things that you know are getting in the way from your focus, or getting in the way from, or distracting you, or taking you in places that God doesn't want you to go. You're allowing Satan to take you there.